Yeah. Oh.
Welcome, everyone, to another Jags podcast, episode 23. And we have a football game to talk about tonight. We are excited. We have the full crew with us. Joey, how you doing?
I'm doing great, man. We got football tomorrow.
We do. Jason, I know you're excited.
I'm so pumped. I can't hold it in.
Robert, how you doing?
Doing good.
Good. All right. It's Saints versus Jags. We're going to talk about that a lot. But before we do that, we want to recognize the music that was provided tonight by local band, bunch of Jags fans. The band is South Point. The song is The Great Escape. Check them out. Really good music, really good dudes. And, of course, Jag fans. Yeah. So we want to support
I dig them.
Yeah, it's a good sound. I like it.
I like it. Nice and chill.
Yeah. Joey, the music critic right there. I like it. It's chill. But also, thank you, South Point, for lending us your music for this episode. We appreciate it. So if you're out and about and are looking for some good music, check them out. We also want to let everyone know that we are on Twitter at Another Jags Pod and Instagram and Facebook at Another Jags Podcast. Listen, the season is upon us. If you have questions, if you have concerns, if you have things that you would like to hear us talk about, let us know. Write us on those platforms. We'd love to hear from all of you Jags fans and include you in this show. We're going to get right into it, guys, because I got a feeling it's going to be a good show. I'm excited. I'm super pumped for the game tomorrow night, and I have a feeling we're going to have a good discussion tonight. Tomorrow night, first preseason game, Saints versus Jags. And before we even get to the game, let me just ask you guys this question really quick. On a scale of 1 to 10, for a first preseason game, where is your level of excitement? And Robert, I'm going to go with you first. Scale of 1 to 10, how excited are you for tomorrow night's first preseason game?
Oh, I'm probably going to say a 7. I want to be higher. I want to be higher right now, but preseason's just always like, especially the first game, I'm so pumped to be there, and then it just kind of slowly trickles down by halftime for me. Probably when I get down there, it's going to be a 10. As soon as I hit the stadium, I'm going to be...
But right now,
right now, probably a 7.
Okay. All right. Joey?
Yeah, usually, I'm a false 10. Like, I'm going into the season looking at all the high points and, like, telling everybody, hey, this is the year. This is the year. But this is actually the year.
Yeah.
So,
yeah.
I mean, there's not even a chart to say how excited I am.
Okay.
I'm put way too much into the preseason.
Yeah. Okay. I hear you. Jason?
10 out of 10. Yeah. 10 out of 10. Yeah, yeah. Like, and I know, like, the trap of getting down there, because it's happened to me before, and being like, okay, preseason. But gauging off of how I felt at the practice scrimmage, there wasn't a play I wasn't like, okay, who is that? Okay, how many yards? What formation were they in? All right, you know, I did that entire time. And so I can't even imagine what's going
to
happen.
I wasn't even just doing that. I was like turning around to people behind me and be like, hey, no, that's Casey.
Yeah, I know.
It's this guy.
I know.
And he does this, and he's got a fast release, according to Jason. It's like, it's amazing. Everybody's like, will you please stop talking to me?
Joey would preface every statement with, excuse me, I'm Joey from Another Jack podcast.
Taking selfies with random people behind him.
But my kids are like, do you know them? I'm like, no, why?
Yeah, like I feel like jumping into people's conversations that weren't talking to me. Like, oh, yeah, he's from Clemson. Like, just jumping in, that I was doing that.
Okay.
Yeah, that was bad.
How about you, James?
I'm a 10 out of 10 as well. And for all the same reasons that you all said, that this is our year. And also, not to mention the fact that the last time that we saw the Jags on the field was in January. It's been a long time. And I don't care that it's the preseason. I don't care that the game doesn't count. I am so ready. Not to mention the fact, and Jason, you kind of alluded to this last week in our episode 22. We just have so many players to watch, so much depth. This isn't like a bunch of scrubs that are going to be coming in the second half that we've never heard of. We know these players. And as we went through all the position groups throughout this summer, I mean, we really got to know these players a lot and who to look for. There's a lot of intrigue and just in terms of the second and third units, I'm excited to see that as well. Normally, you think it's preseason. These starters aren't even going to play. Well, that doesn't really matter as much to me this year because we have so much depth and so much to look at, and it's just, I am excited. On a personal note, I'm taking my daughter to her first Jaguar game tomorrow night, and I am freaking out excited about that. She could care less. She just wants to have a Sprite and, like, snacks the whole game.
Yeah, I suggest the soft pretzel with the cheese. It's, like, the cheapest with, like, the most, like, time it takes
to... No, you gotta go to the $5 menu now.
Yeah, it's perfect timing.
It's $5.
Oh, that's on $5? Oh,
popcorn,
man.
Yep. Popcorn and that are $5
Oh,
now.
Popcorn's gonna be huge.
Yeah.
The fries are, too, aren't they?
Ooh, those cheese fries.
Yeah.
Hot dogs.
Hot
soft
dogs.
Drinks. So, yeah, I'm pumped about that. To share that experience with her, I'm really excited.
Are the Yinglings $5?
No.
They are $12.
No, I think that's just for the cup. But anyways,
put my hand for a nickel.
How much for just one rib? I told you it was going to be a fun episode. If you can't tell, we are excited.
Yeah, we are.
The preseason, for crying out loud. I can't imagine what it's going to be like when September rolls around. But let me ask you guys, okay, another question. Let's really get into the game. What one player, just one, and okay, Jason, one player.
I was about to say, right? Come on now.
How about this? Well, let's do one player on each side of the ball.
Okay.
One offensive, one defensive player that you are looking forward to seeing the most. And let's just do offensive to start, and we'll start with Joey. You look like you're ready.
I am, and it was based off the little scrimmage. Jadon Mickens, man. I want to see what he does in the first preseason game. I mean, I think a lot of the positions are kind of set.
That's a good answer.
I think that he showed out big time in that preseason. I mean, I know it was against some of the second team and third team defenses, but he, again, he talked chip on your shoulder. I think he was living in a car. He had a great partial season last year. He kind of fell off at the end, and I think people are kind of just counting him out. And he looked mad. He was running mad.
Nothing puts a chip on your shoulder like living in a car.
I mean, yeah. You know, I've slept in a car for a night at times because, you know, hotels are expensive and all. But, like, living in
your
car.
Darker days.
Exactly. But living in a car, man, I mean, he's had a taste for it. And that guy, man, he was running fast.
Well, let's stay there for a second because he's an interesting person to be watching because of this reason and this reason alone. The unofficial depth chart came out this week for the Jags. Unofficial meaning it's the preseason. It's not official until they cut their roster down to 53 and they start the regular season. Jadon Mickens, who a lot of us thought was going to be competing for that sixth spot, maybe punt returner, is fourth on the depth chart at wide receiver behind Rashad Green and Shane Wynn.
I don't mean to correct you, but he's fourth on the left wide receiver.
On the left wide receiver, yes.
Meaning that there's a whole three on the right that are ahead of him.
So, either way, it doesn't look good that they have
so
Green
that puts
and
them closer.
Wynn.
It puts them closer to seventh on the depth chart. Is what I'm saying.
Okay, yeah, which is surprising.
Right.
That's not not good. That was what I was saying in a different way, I guess.
Yeah.
So again, as being the fans and not the media or the Uber football people who know everything, what's the cut line? Is it five? Is it six? How many wide receivers are they keeping?
I think they keep six.
Six, yeah,
six.
That's the typical.
So he is kind of like on the borderline at this point. If he's the fourth on the left, he's 6-7 ish.
Yeah, I mean, and it's really who knows because he could be seventh or he could be ninth.
Yeah.
So
yeah. According to, I mean, if they had to make a decision now, he's the odd man out. He's not in.
But who's the only other guy who's going to be able? Well, I guess you got Rashad Green on punt returns as well, right?
Yeah,
I'm not sold on him though. And who knows? I mean, right now, I mean, Marquise Lee. Who knows? D.D. Westbrook could possibly even do the punt returns. If he beats them out, I mean,
why don't we tell the fans? I'll tell the fans real quick where they're at on the depth chart.
Tell them
if you don't know. So 1-2, Keenan Cole, Marquise Lee.
Yep.
Okay.
That's everyone agree with that?
Yep.
Yeah. Okay. Zero argument.
Yeah. That's what we've been saying forever.
Yeah.
3-4, D.J. Chark, D.D. Westbrook.
Like that too.
I would flip him around.
I didn't see that coming, to be honest. But
so that has DJ Chark before.
Well, that's the thing. You don't know.
It's hard
because you don't know who's three or four.
Yeah, they're doing different sides of the field.
We'll say 3-4. So could be third, could be fourth.
Okay.
Chark, I would almost say they're both second team. That's how I look at it.
Yeah.
All right. Then you're at 5-6, interchangeable. Rashad Green, Dante Moncrief.
Yeah.
That means if they keep six and they add a kick returner, Moncrief's cut.
There's no way they're cutting Moncrief.
I don't think so.
Unless his injury is more serious than they're letting it on to be, there's no way they're cutting that guy.
I mean, he's only on a 1-year deal.
And I wonder what financially what they owe if he doesn't make the team.
Yeah, on 1-year
deal. Is it all guaranteed?
Yeah.
It's a $10 million deal. So it's not like it's
I'm
chump
assuming
change.
He has to have 5 or 6 guaranteed.
I
would have had all guaranteed for 1 year, but
I would think it would all be guaranteed, but
yeah.
I think regardless, he's the one receiver out of that group that's not like the rest of them. I think you got to keep that guy.
It's all guaranteed.
It is. Okay.
Yeah, so there's no way that
9.6 with a $4 million signing bonus on top of that.
That would be,
man, he got a lot of money.
So this would not look great if you pull in a guy, even if it's for a 1 year deal, but pay him $9 million and he doesn't even see the field.
It's not happening.
That can't happen. You can't do
why
that.
Why can't it? If they get to practice and he's not contributing like the other guys are, it doesn't matter how much he's
getting
paid.
Because he's injured. there's no way they're going to cut him based on him being injured.
But they're also not going to play him just because they gave him money.
Right.
If he's not as good as everybody, especially on a one-year deal.
Yeah.
Jason brought this up a few episodes ago, I think probably when we were talking about wide receivers. Dante Moncrief is not going to be on this team next year, no matter what happens.
There's no way.
If he's a bust, that's true. They cut him. If he's really good, he's going to go somewhere else.
Yeah.
So they're not invested in him in any way at all. So if he's not performing, it doesn't do them any good to play him just because they're paying him.
God, I wish I was Dante, man. Here's $9 million to chill for a year.
Yeah. But at the same time, he's also, I mean, he's making a ton of money this year, so it's not like he's going to be broke out if he doesn't have a job next year. But he is also playing for his NFL career and his next contract this year as well. So it's an important year for him, no matter where he plays next year. But for the Jags, it's not nearly as important for them as it is for him.
So if he gets cut, we paid him out the $9 million, that was guaranteed, and he goes to another team, do they still have to reform a new contract?
Oh, yeah.
Yes.
Yeah. So, I mean, he might want to get cut at this point in time.
All right, then 7-8, Shane Wynn, DeAndre Smelter.
Never even heard of him.
7-8. Then we get to 9-10, in which we're at Jadon Mickens and Doran Miller.
That's shocking.
He must be muffing punts in practice.
Followed by 11-12, Monte Crockett, Alan Lazard.
Yeah.
Yeah, I've heard nothing about Lazard. You know, that's kind of one of the things we might have thought was like would be a shocker coming in. But yeah, he apparently hasn't done anything. So how much of this do you think is Marone and his like gamesmanship of not wanting to put too much information out there?
Well, that's what I was going to say, is these guys have 4 games to change this. So what we're looking at now more than likely will be completely different than what they go into the season with, because there's 4 games for them to show what they have.
Right. But at the same time, the top 4 guys, Lee, Cole, Westbrook and Chark, I mean, that's solid right there. You know, that's solid.
Everybody agrees they're a lock, right?
So even if like Moncrief makes a team, you're still talking third string receiver for a guy that was supposed to come in and somewhat replace Allen Robinson, and it was kind of a foregone conclusion that he was going to be the starting receiver. Now all of a sudden, going into the first preseason game, he's already knocked down a third string. That's pretty surprising to me. I know he's been hurt, but that was also the knock on him coming in. Yeah. So all that the Colts fans have said is they've been proven right, that the guy can't stay healthy.
Okay, so out of the rest of the receivers, who do you guys want to be that sixth spot if you had a choice?
I think it depends on what we're – if the sixth guy is going to be like just strictly kick returning, I want that guy to be Jadon Mickens. If he's going to be someone that helps us in the passing game, this is assuming, according to this, Rashad Greene – maybe. Rashad Greene, 6. Shane Wynn. I like Shane Wynn a lot. So I think it goes maybe Rashad Greene, Shane Wynn, Jadon Mickens. I think you could throw them all into a hat and pull one out.
Yeah.
Rashad Greene and Mickens both scare me, though, in the sense that they've both muffed at least 2 punts. I mean, Rashad Greene's probably done, I don't know off the top of my head, at least 3 that I remember. And then Mickens did 2 last year. And that was his first year playing. I mean, that's scary to me. I mean, even with the 2 touchdowns, that's 2 big muffs as well.
If I had to pick right now, I would say I would bet Rashad Greene makes the team over Mickens and Wynn. I think he's the 6th wide receiver because he's had a really good camp. Mm-hmm. He has a higher pedigree than the other 2 guys, and he's proven himself on special teams. Yes, he's muffed a couple, but I think last week we talked about how what punt returner hasn't. You know, he's healthy for the first time. And I think he's going to make it. I think he will end up, if he does make it, I think he will end up being higher up on the depth chart than Moncrief. I think Moncrief's going to be a bust. I think it's almost as if, I know it's early, we haven't even played the first preseason game yet, but it's not looking good for him right off the bat.
I agree with you 100%.
Not just that, but the fact that Chark is having a really good camp, and no one saw that coming as much either.
Yeah.
So that makes it even harder for him because Chark is going to be Moncrief in terms of that big body that's going to go up and get the ball. So if he can't beat Chark, then why put him on the field?
Again, I'm kind of basing mine off that scrimmage. I mean, Jason, you were there. Mickens
looked good.
He looked really good.
Yeah, he did.
Like, there was a couple people that stood out, and he was one of them. Mm-hmm. He stood out by, like, a long shot.
Yeah.
I mean, I know the quarterback can get tackled, and, you know, you're not really hitting quite as much, but they were playing hard, and he looked as fast, if not faster, than anybody out there.
What about Wynn? I haven't seen him. I mean, how's he? Did y'all
see him? He had a touchdown in the scrimmage game, too. That's a guy I've been impressed with Shane Wynn. I think he is a good player, and if he makes the team over Mickens, I'm not that mad about it, because the guy, for his lack of size, can get open. It's crazy. I have never seen anything like someone so small. It's just so open all the time. And Blake just seems to find him so easily. You know,
he is tiny too.
Yeah, but I'm telling you, he gets open. I don't know if it's because he's got like short legs and he can like make cuts faster, but the dude is always has separation on the defensive back when I see him in the game, and that speaks to me as a receiver. That's what you need.
Yeah, I mean, he's super talented. I mean, I think he's just 3 inches too short.
Oh, okay. Maybe that's his chip on his shoulder.
It could be, but
I got a 3-inch chip, bro.
Yeah.
All right, can I talk about who I'm excited to watch now?
Yeah, yeah,
yeah. All right, Joey's turn.
I'm not quite done yet, Jason. Gosh. I've got one more thing to say.
We know you have fans, Joey, but so we want to talk too.
Everybody asked me to talk more, so I'm trying to talk more, and you're cutting me off.
You got the defense to go still.
For every one person asking for more of Joey, we got like 10 that are asking for less.
Hey, well, they need to speak up a little louder, and I'll shut up again. But the other thing is that the good thing is we're going to have 2 to 3 super solid wide receivers on the practice squad.
I'm with you. I don't think they stay on the practice squad. I think you'll see these guys get sniped.
You think so?
I do too.
Yeah. Right. Well, hopefully not all of them.
Which is good. Finally.
Yeah.
Finally, we're cutting guys that are going to go to other teams.
There we go. All right, Jason, your turn. You may speak.
Yeah. All right. So the guy I'm looking forward to the most, there's an obvious one, number 6, but number 1 in your hearts, Cody Kessler.
Yeah.
Okay. I think he's been playing pretty well this camp. I was talking to someone on Twitter the other day, and they were like, why are you so high on Cody Kessler? If you like Bortles, he's not going to see the field. So what's the deal? Here's what I'm thinking. He plays really well in preseason. He plays really well when we're destroying teams. And then we trade him for a third-round pick to a terrible team next year. I mean, we saw that happen this year with the Bills trade for A.J. McCarron. Cody Kessler could literally be McCarron next year if he plays well in the preseason and he plays well when we're beating teams.
Or even like the Rob Johnson protocol, you know? I mean,
that's what I'm saying. That guy. Turn that third round pick into something we need, and there you go.
I like
that. Yeah, but do you trade your backup quarterback for a Super Bowl winning team? I mean, if Blake Bortles goes down, you need a quarterback.
I don't think you trade him this year. I think you trade him
after the season.
After the season.
Okay, I see. Yeah, yeah, yep. Yeah. Okay. Yeah, I'd be on board with that in a heartbeat.
Yeah, and I mean, we've seen it happen, so why not? But that's my obvious pick. I just want to really quick say, hopefully I don't steal anyone's, Will Richardson. I was not big on him when we drafted him, but he's kind of winning me over. So I think I really want to watch him and see how he plays that left tackle or that right tackle role, because I'm not a big Jeremy Parnell fan either. So if Will Richardson wins that job this year, you know, I'd be stoked to see that.
Okay.
Now, I will have to give Jason some props, because in that scrimmage, Kessler looked more than serviceable. Like,
yeah.
He looked pretty dang good in spots. Tanner Lee, though, looked awful.
Tanner Lee is not making this team.
I mean, oh my God, I mean, dude. Like,
we knew that the night he was drafted. He's not making the team.
Yeah.
At all.
He's bad.
My 12-year-old.
Why they spent a 6th-round pick on him, I'll never know.
I mean, my 12-year-old was like, where did you just throw that ball? Why do you do that, Dad? I'm like, I have no idea. Ask Jason.
Yeah.
Quick release, bro.
But Kessler looked good.
Kessler looked great.
And he continues to look good on the run, which I'm convinced is his best trait, is when he's moving, he is very accurate.
I definitely think Kessler could come in and win a couple games for us if we need him to.
Hopefully we don't, but it's nice to know that.
Yep.
All right, Robert?
It's a tie for me. It's TJ Yeldon and Corey Grant. I'm just interested to see they had a lot of momentum running at the end of the last year, and I'm excited to see what they're going to do this year backing up Fournette again. And I think they're going to be a pivotal part in our offense when letting Fournette get his legs rested, let them come in and see what they can do. Because, I mean, if we're going to be a run-first team this year, they're going to need to really step up.
On that note, keep your eye on Brandon Wilds. That dude went off in the scrimmage game. Went off. I was like, who is this guy?
What number was he?
He was number 38. He got almost as many snaps as anyone else because he was just playing super well. And he got in there, and I thought it was Tim Cook at first. And I was like, yeah, Tim Cook. And then after a couple plays, I was like, that's not Tim Cook.
Yeah, I thought that was told everybody he was Tim Cook, so I'll have to go back. Sorry, guys, if you're sitting around me, it was
that was
Tim
Joey?
Cook.
Yeah, but Wilds ended up getting those next carries, even though we thought it was going to be Tim Cook. Ended up being Wilds, and he performed pretty well. So watch for him to get a lot of snaps tomorrow.
He's behind Cook right now on the depth chart.
Yeah, I know. I see that, but
we'll see.
Just based off the training, I'll talk about the scrimmage game. He got more carries in the scrimmage game.
I mean, Yeldon's like a good, interesting call, though, because I think they just know what they're going to get out of him. So I don't think we're going to see much from him. We haven't heard much about him. I mean, I think they just know this is this guy. This is what we're going to get out of him. And I don't think we're going to see much.
Well, I hope that we see Yeldon or Grant or even, you know what, going into tomorrow night, honestly, and I'm getting a little ahead of ourselves here, but I hope we only see Cook and Brandon Wilds. At least, or I certainly do not want to see Leonard Fournette play tomorrow night.
I don't want to see him on the field
at all.
Yeah, is there a reason?
He can come out and sweat it for all I care. Don't even dress. So that's why I would look forward to see Yeldon or Grant or Cook or Wilds. any one of those four is fine, but do not put Leonard Fournette on the field tomorrow night because he doesn't need it. We don't need the risk of that either. But I'm going to go kind of in the same lane that Joey was in and say DJ Chark. I am so excited to see him in a game. I love the pick when they drafted him in the second round. I'm high on him. I think he's going to have a great rookie campaign. He's had a good camp so far, and I think he's going to surprise a lot of people. A lot of people. And so I'm excited to see him run some routes, see how fast, how big he really is going up against some other competition. You know what else we haven't mentioned, what I'm excited about for tomorrow night's game, is seeing the new uniforms in action.
Yeah.
You know? It's the first time seeing it. So I'm looking forward to that, seeing what they look like under the lights, you know, on the field and competition.
They saw them on the scrimmage game. I mean, they wore them.
They were full-blown uniforms, weren't they? Practice, right? Practice jerseys?
It's the same thing.
That's what says.
Yeah, it's very similar. It's the same thing.
I was about to say, I'm pretty sure they're the uniforms, right?
But now that I think back,
They were wearing them.
Yeah, I think they were.
They were.
They were?
It was the white and the black.
Yeah. Oh, okay.
Yeah.
All right. Well, I didn't go, so I'm excited to see the uniforms in the game. But, yeah, I guess Safarian Jenkins, I would like to see him play as well just because he's new to the team and been hearing a lot of good things about him. But I'm not sure how much he plays tomorrow night.
Probably a drive or two.
Yeah.
If last year is any indication.
And again, to give other members here some props, I mean, Jason seemed to have nailed that. I mean, I've not heard anything but Safarian Jenkins being an absolute stud.
I'm telling you, dude, he destroyed us, and it hurt me. Hurt me bad.
Yeah.
When Safarian Jenkins destroyed us.
I remember that game and just going, I really didn't know who he was at that point in time, too. I mean, it's just like, what is going on right now? They keep throwing to him, and he's blowing us up.
I mean, I haven't heard anything bad about him from any standpoint.
He's big.
Yeah. That could be huge.
Before we move on to the defense, I just want another little pop quiz for you guys.
Oh, God.
Can anyone remember, if you can remember the scores, bonus points.
Oh, wow.
Who we played in the first preseason game last year?
Well, was it the Bucks?
Nope.
Hold on. Okay, let me. Wasn't the Falcons? We always play the Falcons. Oh, was it the Giants?
Nope.
Dolphins? Wasn't the Giants?
I'll give y'all a hint. AFC team.
I could have sworn it was the Giants.
AFC East team.
Okay, slow down. Oh, it was the Patriots.
Patriots.
Yeah, that's right. I remember that. I remember that.
And we beat them.
And we beat them. Yeah,
they
won.
Yeah.
Yep. Should have beat them twice that year.
That's right, because we did our practice with them.
Yeah, and just stayed up there for the game.
Yeah, we just stayed up there for the game. That's right.
And then we scored 8 points against the Bucks in the second preseason game and lost. That's when people were starting to get mad. Then we lost to the Panthers by 1 point in the third preseason game. And then we beat the Falcons 13-7 in the fourth preseason game.
Yeah.
I mean, really, though, the third preseason game is the only thing that really matters.
That's what people always say, but the Jags played their starters a lot last preseason.
Well, that's because they were terrible.
They had to play. They didn't know who their starters were last year.
I don't think it's so much of that as it is. That's just the way Marone does it, to be honest with you.
Okay.
I mean, I think guys
I hope
like,
he does it different this year.
I mean, I think guys like Leonard Fournette, obviously the older guys, Campbell, I think they will not play very much, but I think, I mean, Marone plays these guys a lot more than other people do. I mean, wasn't Bortles getting snaps in the fourth quarter against the Panthers?
Yes, because
he was benched that game.
Chad Henne was the starting quarterback in that game.
That's true.
I mean, that and our offensive line.
That's how bad our preseason was last year.
That they were just going to be a sieve all year. I mean, they had to, is what I thought. But, I mean, maybe not. Maybe that's how he is. He's hard-nosed and he's old school. I mean, if you're a first, second, third-year player, I mean, I don't disagree. Why not get out there and play? It's your job.
I don't know. I really hope that's not the case this preseason. The word coming out of the Jaguars last year during the preseason, especially going into that fourth game, was we don't know who our offensive line is yet, and these guys need to continue to compete. We don't care that it's a fourth preseason game. That's where they were at. And then, again, I don't know what happened, but they flipped a switch when it counted and made us all forget about the preseason. I just cannot see that being the case this year. I cannot see that being the case.
Yeah, but when your mentality is we're going to beat you down and beat you on any opportunity we get except for preseason, I don't know, man.
No, I'm not saying that that mentality changes, but I'm just saying you do it with different players. Beat them down with Tim Cook and Brandon Wilds. Don't beat them down with Leonard Fournette.
That is a good thing. There are lots of guys that we need to get a better look at and need a lot of snaps to see where they're going to fit into. So
right.
that's kind of cool.
Yeah. I'm not saying you don't try and win, although, and I hopefully I know the answer to this question, but do you guys at all care if the Jags win their preseason games? Does that matter to you?
That's not what I'm saying at all. I could give. I don't care who wins, who loses. But my point being is like Yannick Ngakoue said, like he's got these moves that he's practicing. Why not try that stuff that you're not quite comfortable with in a preseason game? Whether you win or lose, you're getting some actual kind of more serious reps at it. Try some stuff or plays or whatever that you're not quite great at or you wouldn't normally run all the time because it doesn't matter. I mean, I like that kind of polish. That's where we're at.
Okay, well, let's just go ahead and since we're talking about it, let's just dive right in. How many snaps do you see Ngakoue playing tomorrow night?
I think that's kind of up to him.
Probably 15.
I think two drives, whatever that is. So if it's
I don't know. Maybe I'm just being conservative and this is fear-based and that's what you can't do that. But for the first preseason game, I'd say one series, honestly.
I think you got to give him two just because there's something different about playing a series, taking a rest, and then getting back out there. Kind of like the old adage of like coming out of the half, you play your starters to get it's kind of the same thing. It's a different thing you want your players to see. Like, okay, I sat down for a series, talked to the coaches now, get up and do it again. And then once you've done that, I think you're good.
Yeah.
I think the other thing, which we haven't talked about much, that is going to be different this preseason, and I think they're going to play more than they normally would have, is the new tackling rule, the lowering your head.
Yeah, we already saw that already.
Yeah. And these guys need reps at that. Whether you're a running back that is going into somebody and getting hit, your instincts to lower your head. I mean, I think they need reps at that to get used to it.
Yeah, because that rule's going to be a absolute mess this year.
Yeah, it looks like
they're gonna call it. I mean, the very first preseason game, they already, in my opinion, called it wrong.
Well, did you hear they had someone mic'd up or someone reported it and said that they asked the official, why they called it, and the official said, it's the preseason, I have to call it. So, like, I think they're going to overdo it in the preseason to try to...
They always try and drive the point home in the preseason when it doesn't matter.
It's true, but the one that he called was nowhere close to what the rule is. The guy
it doesn't matter. That's not the point. It's a point of emphasis for the league, and so do it in preseason. Make it look like the league is having a strong stance on it so that the players will try and adapt. Again, when it doesn't count... And then when the regular season starts, the league's hope is that the players will have adapted to it by then. But you see that every single preseason that happens.
Okay, well, I'm going to have to take another stance on this. If I'm a coaching staff and I don't know how it's going to be called for sure, I'm going to want my guys in there because I don't want that first game going out there and us having 15 penalties for 150 yards and losing because I didn't prepare my guys appropriately. How do you know that's going to happen?
This new rule is such a scary rule where it's either going to not be called at all or it's going to be called nonstop and it's going to kill this season.
I mean, unless behind the scenes they're like telling everybody, hey, we're just putting that out there for like what you said, James. It'll make the game a little safer, but we're not going to call it. This is how we're going to call it, and they know that already. I don't see how you don't prepare them for that, and that means more snaps in preseason.
So I don't know. I mean, to both of your points, Joey, with Ngakoue specifically, not every player on the team, but for Ngakoue specifically, I just don't think that guy needs preseason reps to be ready. He's been working every day in the offseason, basically. I mean, he's a different animal, though. If it was up to him, he'd probably want to play the whole game.
And that's my point, is a guy like that wants to get in there and have the
snaps. But that doesn't mean that he should. Just because he wants to doesn't mean that he should.
Well, it's a question, should he or will he?
I think.
Okay, no, I don't think he should get a ton of snaps.
Okay. But, and also about the adapting to the new rules, I mean, if they're not coaching that during practice already, then they're messing up big time. I mean, that stuff should be addressed the first day of training camp, first preseason.
They're not doing a lot of live tackling in practice, though.
And you also don't have.
They're doing directional stuff, you know.
Yeah, I mean, as far as like, it's just different when you're tackling someone to the ground. I mean, there may be like a period of that, but a lot of times in practice they're just thudding and they're just trying to, you know, wrap up.
Also don't have an NFL officiating crew there making the calls. I mean, in practice,
they get officials out there.
They're doing this.
In practice, really?
Yeah.
No, even in practice, they have officials out there.
That's pretty sweet. Learn something new tonight, guys.
Yeah. I don't know. It is, the new rule is weird. We'll see how, you know, what they do. I guess there is, you know, a time where they need to figure that out. But I don't know. To me, there's the goal this year for the Jags is to win the Super Bowl. That is the goal. And so how much do you risk that to have your star players playing an extra series so they can figure out how to tackle, you know, without leading with their helmet? That's all I'm saying. It's just such lofty goals. I would hate to see something happen in the preseason to affect that goal. If it happens in the regular season, fine. That's when games count. But the preseason, come on. These guys are elite players in the league. They know what they're doing. If it was me, I would scale them back and you know, play him more in the second and third, not even play him at all in the fourth, and then get ready for the Giants week one, and let's see what happens.
I agree with you. The only thing that concerns me, and not to beat the horse on the new rule and everything, is that we have a defense that's a very physical defense. These guys come in and they hit hard. They're all cocky too, and this rule for our team scares me so bad that if they're going to enforce this, we could be in a lot of penalty trouble.
I think if they enforce this, every single team is going to be in penalty trouble because it's a ridiculous rule.
Especially like Dante Fowler.
Well, I think the Colts will be all right because they really can't tackle anyway.
That's true.
Yeah.
All right, well, I think that's a good place to pause for a second. We'll come back. We're going to take a quick break and come back and talk about the defensive player that we're looking forward to seeing the most. And who knows what rabbit trails we're going to go down for that conversation. As we lead into the break, this is, again, South Point you're listening to. The song is The Great Escape. The podcast is Another Jags Podcast. And we are your number one off-season Jaguars podcast. We'll be right back. Welcome back, everyone, to episode 23 of Another Jags Podcast. Thanks again to South Point with the song The Great Escape, providing us with music tonight. They are Jacksonville boys. They are Jaguars fans. We're excited to have them be a part of this episode. If you are a musician or a band out there and would like to have your music featured, give us a shout-out on Twitter, at Another Jags Pod, Instagram, Facebook, Another Jags Podcast. We'd love to hear from you. Also, if you are not a musician, just have questions for us that you would like us to answer, topics you would like for us to discuss, let us know. Give us your feedback. Listen, the season is almost upon us, and it's an exciting time. You know, everyone has things that you want to talk about, so let us know, and we'll try and incorporate those into the show. But tonight, it's all about the first preseason game, the Saints versus the Jags. We've talked about who we want to see on the offensive side of the ball. Now we're going to go to our stronger side of the ball, the defense, and talk about a player that we'd like to see that we're going to kind of focus on. And Robert, we're going to start with you this time. Who is the player that you are looking forward to seeing the most tomorrow night on the defensive side of the ball?
Leon Jacobs would be mine at this right now because, I mean, when we were going over all the position groups and stuff, I mean, at the time, we all were pretty sure that Blair Brown was going to be filling that role, but now that he is going to be backing up Telvin Smith as of now on the depth chart, I'm excited to see what Leon Jacobs is going to bring to that Sam position. That being said, if he's not playing a whole lot just as a starting position, I have to imagine they're going to play him a good bit. But if not, Ronnie Harrison's probably going to be the next choice for me.
That's an easy one.
He took James and Jason's like right there. Straight off the bat.
Just backhanded answer.
Listen, he didn't go. He got to go third last time on offense. He gets to take his
spot. I agree 100%.
That's fair.
I think it's interesting, though, that to the point about Leon Jacobs, I mean, he's number one. He's a starter on defense on the depth chart. The coaches seem like they are sold on him. And I personally, I haven't even seen him play yet. I don't see that changing.
Well, it can all change too, but Blair Brown's not even listed as a backup for the Sam position. So, I mean, he's not even over on that side. So, it's going to be interesting to see what actually happens with that position. And hopefully, Leon Jacobs' the guy and he does well for it. So,
I mean, on that note, it's interesting to hear what other players have to say about a new guy like that. And you hear like Telvin Smith, you hear multiple other guys on the team talk about how smart the dude is.
Yeah.
Which is. That's what you want to hear. I mean, obviously the guy's got the physical attributes. I mean, my God. But they talk about that he's like year two or three as far as like schemes go, as far as like the playbook goes. Like the guy's just smart. And Carline had an interview with him, and I liked what I heard. Other than the fact that he sounds like Mike Tyson. Anybody listen to
Does
that?
Does he? No.
Yeah,
but if he comes calling, like that's the first thing I'm going to tell him. If I ever meet Leon Jacobs and say, Joey said you sound like Mike Tyson, then he's going to crush you.
Oh, of course. Never said that to his face. Love you.
Not at all.
Just no face tat.
No, I've heard the same thing. I've heard how smart he is, and I think that's probably why he won the job. It's because he knows where to be already. So I'm looking forward to – I agree, Robert. I'm looking forward to seeing him a lot. And based on what we talked about last week, if you didn't listen, episode 22, we talked a lot about Leon Jacobs and just his size. Even Miles Jack said the guy's a complete specimen physically, so I'm looking forward to seeing him tomorrow night. I think he'll, of all the starters, obviously, I think he's going to play the most just because he's a rookie.
Yeah,
He needs it. He needs to play. So we'll see.
Well, if you went on our Twitter, I previewed this answer a little bit. I'm really excited to see Ronnie Harrison because he plays like a outside linebacker, at that safety spot, and I love guys that kind of play like that. Kind of Derwin James is kind of the same way in that sense. He reminds me of that, and he's so athletic and so big, and he can hit so hard, and he has good ball skills. I'm excited to see him. I think he will push for a spot on the field. We saw the Jags roll Tayshawn Gibson and Barry Church down into the box on a lot of sets, and I think you might see that with Ronnie Harrison now. And they can actually leave Church and Gibson back in those safety spots. And then I think Ronnie Harrison may take some snaps away from the Sam linebacker because of his ability to set the edge. So I'm excited to see how he plays.
So you think he could be a hybrid safety linebacker?
Yeah, right.
Okay,
yeah.
So you're not saying he's big enough
to be one.
Yeah, you're saying he's huge. You're not saying that he's going to take snaps away from Church or Gibson.
Right.
Okay.
Right. I'm saying he'll take snaps away from, and not like at that position, but just in the scheme of what the Jags will be trying to do, he'll be taking snaps away from the Sam linebacker or the nickel corner.
I mean, he's been getting a lot of praise from the veterans as well, big time. Obviously, we haven't even officially started the preseason yet. The game's tomorrow. But this could be arguably the best rookie class the Jags have ever had. I mean, I know, Joey, you're laughing. It's presumptuous.
No, I'm laughing because going last sucks, because I was about to say the exact same thing.
Oh, really?
I agree. Like 1,000%. Like, it's, like if they hit on these players,
yeah.
Talk about we'll have to go back to our podcast and like redo that as far as how the drafting and free agency. I mean, it's amazing if they're all that good.
Yeah. If Leon Jacobs is starting already, I mean,
seventh round pick.
We could be looking really good.
But we're talking about Leon Jacobs getting in the starting job. Ronnie Harrison coming in and competing to start, you know, and have some snap. DJ Chark is going to play. It's funny that the first round pick, Taven Bryant, is probably going to be the one that plays the least out of, you know, a lot of them, which, you know, he was an investment pick. We all know that. He was never going to unseat Calais Campbell by any stretch of the imagination. But it's just, man, what a stacked draft this could be. Jason's already mentioned Will Richardson and what he could possibly do. I mean, who knows? Gosh, talk about we did a discussion about David Caldwell being a good GM. I think this would solidify that, regardless of whether it was him or Coughlin. I mean, my goodness, what a draft this could really be.
Tanner Lee could take the starting quarterback job.
That's the one asterisk in the whole thing. Don't get me started on him. Quick release. Hashtag quick release.
Yes. Quick release 15 yards in front of somebody that's on defense.
He looks like he's like spiking the ball.
Hey, Tanner, you can't get hit. You don't have to be scared, man.
It's like swatting at a mosquito.
Now, that does segue kind of into what I'm looking forward to, James.
Tanner Lee?
No, not Tanner Lee.
He plays offense, Joey.
I know that.
I'm talking about right before that. We were talking about how great of a draft class this could be. And it goes to Taven Bryan. I mean, that guy is a work in progress, but he's kind of jumped ahead of Smoot, which to me, I don't know what happened to Smoot. Because last year, man, there were flashes where that guy looked like a maniac. Like, he just ran into people and just bolt. I mean, he looked scary. And if Taven Bryan's better than him first year at this point, that says a lot about him as well. So I'm kind of interested to see how that dynamic plays out.
Is Taven Bryan playing tomorrow night? I know he hasn't officially been listed as out. I think the only one so far that has is Enku, Eli Enku. Is how you pronounce his name?
If I had to guess, I would say he probably will. But we don't know. Like you said, Eli Enku is the only guy that's out as of now. But, I mean, I would doubt Calais Campbell is going to play. And, you know, I would doubt, honestly, Leonard Fournette only got 9 carries in the first preseason game his rookie year. So I can't imagine him getting any carries tomorrow night. But
I'll be honest, and I think this shouldn't be a shock based on what I said about Ngakoue playing. I would not play any starter on defense tomorrow night except Leon Jacobs. And DJ Hayden, if you consider him a starter. I wouldn't play. Definitely wouldn't play Ramsey or Boye at all. Wouldn't play Telvin or Miles Jack. I don't think they need it. Maybe Miles a couple, just because, you know, he is still filling in that role of the defensive captain in terms of calling the plays and the formations and the huddle. But I wouldn't play anyone on the defensive line. I wouldn't play anyone. And, I know they will, but if it was me, I would not play. I don't think Malik, Calais, or Marcel Darius, especially. I don't think those three, they don't need preseason snaps, especially the first game. Ngakoue, it's his third year, maybe a little bit, but if it was me, I wouldn't play any of them.
So you don't think there's anything to say for rhythm and chemistry? There's a lot of new guys at least around these people in some plays. I mean, I agree the vets should not play, but I mean,
you can't just sit everybody. Why?
Because they're going to go into the first real game and not have any.
I think it would be better for the team to have second team players get more reps than the first teamers right now. Those guys, they're one of the biggest benefits to this defense is their continuity. The fact that they did all play together last year, except Leon Jacobs. Here's my point in it: Campbell, Malik Jackson, Marcel Darius, Telvin Smith, Jalen Ramsey, and AJ Boye, and Church and Gibson as well, are not going to be better players because they play against the Saints in the first preseason game.
No, but it could be a nice just kind of shake off the dust. I mean, when you play in practice, it's nowhere the same thing as playing even in a preseason game because you're going up against guys that are actually trying to come at you.
I'm not saying they don't play at all in the preseason. I'm saying they don't play in the first preseason game.
Oh.
I would say don't play in this game at all. Play in the second game, play in the third, and then sit them the fourth. And they're going to be, these guys are professional football players, and most of them are in the top, they're like the best at their position. All right, we're not talking about old players for the Jags that were barely, you know, making it in the league. These are the elite in their position. They're not going to get better playing tomorrow night.
I agree, but you also, I mean, I know this shouldn't be the reason, and whether we agree with it or not, you got to do it for the fans too, though. You got to have those guys come out in the first game of the game.
I could not disagree more with that.
That was going to be my point, though. So, James, the only reason these guys play in the preseason is to sell more tickets then. There's absolutely no benefit other than that. That's the only reason these guys are out there.
When these guys, yes, in the first game, I would lose my mind.
James
if
is getting
I found
really
out,
red right now.
I would lose my mind if I found out that Marone and them going, you know, we better play Ramsey so that the fans don't get mad.
That wouldn't be their decision. That's in front office.
Then why doesn't every team sit all their starters?
They should. That's what I'm saying. They should.
So only for ticket sales.
No.
No, because as a season ticket holder, Jason's already is a season ticket holder. He's already paid for that game.
Okay, but I'm talking from like a non-season ticket holder standpoint. No. If I knew none of those guys were playing, I would never go to a preseason game.
They hardly do. They're playing. They're going to play one series.
Preseason tickets are cheap.
Yeah, but you're saying
there's
would go
the
to
hope a, that they'll play, and you get to see them for a few series.
No.
Here's what I'll say. Okay, I think the fans thing is a non-issue. I don't think the coaches give
one. I think if
one,
you're an owner, the fans
think,
thing
yeah,
is a
I don't
huge
think it's
issue.
The coaches.
The owner
the front
has
office.
No say. They have no say.
What? The front office doesn't have say?
I'll tell you. The owner doesn't have a say on what goes on the team. The front office does not give a crap about
ticket sales?
Playing ticket sales in the preseason.
So the guy who writes everybody's check doesn't have any say in
the
preseason.
That's why he hired Coughlin.
No, dude.
If you are sitting here and you honestly think that they are deciding who is playing in the preseason based on ticket sales, you're crazy.
No, that's not what I'm saying at all. What I'm saying is there is a benefit to those guys playing in preseason because it's chemistry, it's rhythm, it's shaking the dust off. What I'm saying is that if you don't think that any of them should play, then the only reason that makes sense that they do play is for ticket sales.
I am telling you that I don't think they should play in the first preseason game. And I'm trying to figure out what you're saying to me.
Joey's saying by default, if they're not playing for chemistry and they're not playing for to get better, the only reason they are playing is for ticket sales.
And I'm sure that's what the coaches are saying. But what I am saying now is this team, this defense, does not need in the first preseason game to do what you were saying, which is continuity, shaking the dust. They can accomplish that in the second and third game.
Now, I was playing a little devil's advocate there because I agree 1,000% with the defense. Okay. I don't think any of those guys need to play, but on the offense, I do think there's a huge benefit to Bortles getting some reps with like Chark and those guys.
Yeah, totally. Okay. I agree on that. And I'm not saying the Jaguars last year, I wouldn't be saying this because there was a lot of different players and guys. But what we saw last year, and I think hopefully we would all agree on this, what we saw last year from the defense, they do not need this game. They don't need it to play and to accomplish what they're going to. They are so hungry already. They are all holding each other accountable. They can shake the dust off next week. They can get their continuity and the game speed next week in the third preseason game. They do not need it tomorrow night. Listen, Breeze isn't playing.
Yeah,
Breeze isn't going to play tomorrow night.
Yeah,
so it's not like they're going up against like any real competition. I don't know if Kamara's going to play or...
I doubt Kamara will play.
So they're not even facing real competition.
Isn't it Savage?
No.
They got Savage, Taysom Hill, and JT Barrett.
Yeah. So there you go. Case in point, all right? Is really Savage... Oh, man, guys, we got to get him to game speed. We got Tom Savage, you know, in the preseason.
Hey, Taysom Hill is fun to watch.
That's it right there.
Taysom Hill... Okay, but okay, here's... I'll just challenge you to think of it a little differently, and this is what I'm thinking that the coaches are thinking, is they're not really looking at it as a set of four games. In their head, they have like a snap count that they want... And I think Joey has a good point for camaraderie. There's a snap count they have for all these guys that play together. So that may be 30 to 50. So they have in their head 30 to 50 snaps that they want this unit to get together. If they don't play at all in the first game, they're still going to need to get those 30 to 50 snaps in. So by not playing the first two series in the first game, you're adding a series to the second and third game. So really their chances of injury are still the same because the coaches have that rep count in their head that they want them to have. Now, it may be dramatically lower than it was last season, which I think it is. And for some guys, Clayus Campbell, it's probably, you know, not there because of how old he is. But there's something about that camaraderie. Like if Leon Jacobs is out there making calls and he's like soft-spoken like Mike Tyson, the D-line can't hear him, that's something they figure out during preseason. And the D-line, like Clayus Campbell and Lee Jackson go, hey, bro, we can't hear you. You got to speak up. Like when there's a real crowd going and the other team is simulating a snap count, you got to be louder so we can hear you. And that's stuff that you get through camaraderie snaps. And I think that's why they have a number in their head, 30 to 50, that these players are going to get regardless of what team it's against and who they're playing.
I'm sure they will. I'm not saying that they won't play tomorrow night, but I don't know. Everything that we've read and we've heard about this defense, and even in just this training camp, is the camaraderie is there. I mean, these guys are holding each other accountable. Telvin Smith is leading. Jalen Ramsey came in, and we talked about it last week. When he stepped on the field in training camp for the first time, the intensity went up like 15 notches, you know? So I just, to me, If we're talking about continuity and all that stuff, to me that's already there for them. Now, if you're talking about little things like not being able to hear someone call the plays, that's one thing, and you can't really. But again, I think all that can be accomplished in a couple games. And remember, we're not talking about a 16 game season for the Jags this year. We're talking about a 19 game season. We want to see them go to the Super Bowl, and so like I would. That is what, and they're not. Maybe they are going to come out and say the coaching staff probably won't. Players are. They already have. But I want to see them fresh, you know, when the season starts. And that if that means even playing a little bit less in the preseason, I'm all for it. I just think this defense is so stacked. They just don't need four preseason games or even three. Let them have two. That's my point.
I'm with you. I just think it's more about snap counts than it is games. And I want to see them get – that's why I say drives, really, when it comes to how much they're going to play. I want to see them get about 20 – snaps together.
Okay.
And so I don't care when that comes. I don't care if it's the fourth game. That four is too many games. I agree. But they need to get at least 20 snaps. And the coaches are probably at a higher number than that. So that's the only thing I'm thinking. And the players will want that together, yeah. I think. So
I mean, my main thing is that, again, I do think they need some reps. I don't care if we win or lose the games. I just hope that all the reps are at the beginning of the games, first quarter. I don't think they ever need to play outside of that because I really think the chance of injury increases after that when you've got a lot of second, third, fourth string guys trying to show out, trying to make the team. Those are the guys that are flying around, and I think that's when the chance of getting hurt really skyrockets up. So as long as they're out after the first quarter, I don't care how much they play.
Okay. All right, fair enough. I think we've talked about that enough. Jason, you mentioned one player on defense, but that's usually only the start how you answer a question. You got any more players you're looking
for? Yeah, can I take this in a different direction, though?
Please.
I'm excited to see Logan Cook, the punter. That dude balled out in the scrimmage game.
We're on defense.
I could not believe. Have you ever seen a punting performance that good in your life, Joey?
He kicked a punt that I didn't believe that he kicked. Like, I thought somebody shot it out of a cannon. You could hear it. It was in the air it was impressive.
The dude had four punts inside the 5-yard line, and like two of them bounced out of bounds. They weren't like downed by special teams players. This dude is so accurate, and everything coming out of camp is saying he's a better field goal kicker than Josh Lambeau. That's what people are saying.
He's big, too. He's pretty tall, right?
Yeah, he's like 6'4".
He's solid.
6'4", like 210.
Wow. I think he might make the Pro Bowl if it's anything like he was in that scrimmage.
I'm not kidding you. That was the – and I'm not one to get excited about special teams. Well, yeah, I am. But that is the best punting performance I have ever seen in my own eyes.
It was crazy.
It was unbelievable.
It looked fake. Like, oh, wow. Seriously.
Well, hopefully and we don't think about see it like too this, much. Too. I mean, if that holds up and he's putting the ball inside the five, offenses aren't going to stand a chance against our team. Our team is going to pin their ears back and go after him. I mean, that's huge.
They're going to have to run three times and just punt it back to us. Right. That's what they're
going
to have to do.
It's funny you mentioned that because I wasn't going to because I was like, I'm not going to say something about a punter.
It stood out. I
was
like,
but, dude, it stood out. It was amazing.
Well, it was a major story on Twitter. I was following the scrimmage on Twitter, and I was like, the punter? Really? I mean, it was crazy. So, apparently, we'll see. I mean, if doing it in a scrimmage is one thing, can he do it, continue to do it?
Well,
sometimes people just have good nights.
That's
true. So, we'll have to wait and see.
That's absolutely true.
I mean, hope not.
It was a good night. It had to have been a good night because I've never seen anything like that before. Yeah. the dude was bouncing it out of bounds on the 2-yard line, like, consistently. And you're just like, what?
Yeah.
You also don't have a guy actually trying to run in and take you out, too. So.
I don't know, dude. They were coming after him. The special teams plays, they weren't joking around, it seemed like to me. There was a play. I mean, we talk about how they were kind of going soft, but there was a play in that game.
They were crossing the field and they spun each other. Did you see that one?
But I was going to refer to the one that Telvin Smith destroyed TJ Yeldon. Like, this is a scrimmage game, and he, like, laid him out, and you're like, whoa.
He probably deserved it.
D.D. Westbrook about had his head ripped off with that face mask.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, I mean, it was minimal contact in a lot of areas, but in a lot of areas it wasn't. So yeah,
they were intense.
All right, so Joey, have you said your defensive player you're looking forward to seeing?
Yeah, it was the Taven Bryan. Smoot. Okay. I just want to see how that works out because I think it's kind of crazy that he jumped over him again as a rookie. So that's a good sign.
Yeah, that is. I hope he plays. I mean, I don't know if he's hurt in any way. He may not play because I think they err on the side of caution with your first round pick. But we'll see. I'm hoping he plays because I'm dying to see Taven Bryan. I don't think any of us knew much about him when he was drafted.
I mean, I just really think that he was just an error of the McElwain lack of caring at Florida. I mean, I think that all the physical attributes are there, and I think if he had a real coach, everybody would have known who he was.
You're a big McElwain fan.
No, I'm a Butters McChompers. Is not my fan. A fan of, I'm not his fan at all.
No.
Okay. Not at all.
Well, I'm looking forward to seeing – I was going to say Leon Jacobs as well. I'm going to go with DJ Hayden, though, just because I think that's probably the biggest question mark on the team is how is he going to work? It seems like he's had a pretty good camp. I don't know a ton about him, so I'm looking forward to seeing how he performs, filling Aaron Colvin's spot. We'll see. I think he's going to benefit from the defense around him, but that's fine as long as he does his job. So I'll be looking to see how he does. Also, Tyler Patman, just because he seems like he's been having a good camp. Be nice to get some good corner depth. So I think he's going to get a lot of playing time as well. So I'm looking forward to seeing how he does. And I think but really it's Leon Jacobs. I'm really excited to see what he does.
DJ Hayden, nothing stood out to me in his coverage skills, but there was one play where they called a nickel blitz, and he came in uncovered to Blake's backside, and if it were live, Blake would have been destroyed.
Right.
But
I mean, it's hard to clap for that when it's
Exactly. And he got a lot of praise after that, and I feel like it was mostly because of that play when it was just unblocked.
Right. I mean, didn't he intercept a Tanner Lee pass that was thrown directly to him?
It was the only pass Tanner Lee threw to anybody all night.
Besides the mascot who he had knocked out.
Yeah. There was a run there where he had 7 incompletions in a row. Yeah.
Wow.
He overthrew everybody to the right side of the field. I mean, literally, he almost hit a chair. Like, it was awful.
They were keeping, they were running, live down in distance. But then when he got in the game, he literally 7 incompletions in a row. Like, they let him just keep going.
I feel like the Jags draft was going so good at that point that someone dared Caldwell to take it. You know, it's like, you
Terry,
won't,
man.
and then Caldwell got a steak dinner for it or something.
I think the cool thing about Hayden is that he really just has to be slightly above average and not make too many mistakes.
Right, he doesn't have to be
great. He doesn't have to do a lot. I mean, he just has to do his job and not much above that, and he's going to fill that gap, and we're going to be fine. So I'm not worried about that.
All right, so I think we've said about all we can about each side of the ball that we were looking forward to seeing. So, Jason, give us a quick just what to expect on the for our opponents, the Saints. What is there anything that we need to be looking out specifically on that side of the ball?
Well, I was talking to some Saints fans earlier in the week, and they kind of gave me a little breakdown of what they're going to be looking for. The first thing they're excited about is the backup quarterback position. There's a battle between the newly signed Tom Savage, Taysom Hill from BYU, and JT Barrett from Ohio State. Those are, Savage is pretty boring, but the other two are pretty exciting quarterbacks to watch. They're pretty mobile. I like Taysom Hill a lot. He was really electric reminds me a little bit of Johnny Manziel. So I think he'll be fun to watch. He'll probably get a lot of reps. Their third running back spot is going to be really important because Mark Ingram is suspended for the first four games of the season. So Kamara's a good player. He probably won't get a lot of reps. So they got some guys that are going to, they just drafted, you know, they got Boston Scott, Trey Edmonds, Jonathan Williams, Terrence West, Shane Vereen, a bunch of guys back there that'll just be fighting for that third spot. They're pretty weak at wide receiver. They're set with Thomas at one. Cameron Meredith's pretty good. But then you got like Ted Ginn. They got a rookie from UCF named Traquan Smith who's been playing really well in the training camp. But they're excited about him. They think he's going to be a good player. And the last thing they're looking for is linebacker rotation. They got Manti Te'o, AJ Klein, Craig Robertson, Alex Anzalone from Florida. So they got guys that are not that good at linebacker, but it'll be interesting. You'll probably see a lot of Manti Te'o. For the Gator fans, you'll see a lot of Alex Anzalone. You probably won't see any of Drew Brees, probably won't see any of Kamara, but they're touting an amazing defense this year, so we will see if that is true or not. Hard to get excited about the Saints. They're nice people, though. So
yeah. Yeah.
But again, they are one of the teams that have a legitimate shot of going to the Super Bowl as well, right? I mean, wouldn't you agree?
Absolutely. I mean, yeah, they probably should have gone last year.
Not with Drew Brees on the bench.
Well, of course not. Yeah. But I mean, that kind of ties into...
Well, they bolstered their defense. So that's kind of the big thing for them this year is their offense was good. Defense was a little lackluster. So we'll see if they've really improved it or not. They've made some moves, but they brought in a bunch of just like mid-level guys at linebacker. Nothing that really stands out. So I don't know. We'll see what happens there. They got some exciting players at the skill position, which is fun to watch. Sean Payton's a good coach. You got to give him credit for that.
Yeah.
So
I don't have anything to add.
You know anything about the Saints?
No, nothing about the Saints.
And y'all watch Hard Knocks last night?
No, not on HBO. Maybe. But let me ask you guys this. Antonio Callaway, he getting cut?
No, he's not getting cut, man. You can't, can't get rid of that man. No.
Actually, I was so interested in what Jason was saying about the Saints, I got on Twitter, and I just read that the team actually believes that he's telling the truth, or sources say that the team believes he's telling the truth, that he had just gotten his car back from his friends who had borrowed it in Florida, and he didn't know that the things that were in there were in fact in there. And the team, the Cleveland Browns, believe him.
Why wouldn't they?
I mean, he's a got a great record.
He's a stand-up individual. Right? He's never had an issue with that in the past. I mean, everybody gets a second chance, right?
I'm not talking from first-hand experiences. I've just heard if you get into a car with weed in it, it's hard not to know immediately that there's weed in the car.
And also, Antonio Callaway, and that's just you smell it all the time.
Yeah, especially a lot of clothes. It.
And also, a 19-year-old kid shouldn't have a 40-year-old friend that just happens to be a drug dealer. I mean,
and there's like gun parts in the car.
Yeah, he makes bad decisions all over the place.
Yeah, he does.
But he's really fast, so you know.
What a wreck!
He's a good receiver, though.
He's a great receiver. I mean, he's
if there is a team for him in the NFL, it's the Cleveland Browns, or maybe the Bengals.
He's going to pull a Justin
Raiders.
Blackman.
He's in that same tier as Blackman, where he's just like. Would rather be intoxicated than play football.
Right. There's a few
sad.
Of those.
Yeah, there is. And
I'd
it's
rather
sad,
be
but
intoxicated than make a few million dollars.
Eugene Monroe? He's out of league because of that.
Evan Britton. People forget about him. He struggled with weed. Yeah. And there's just guys who would rather do that. And money just isn't it for him.
Right.
So,
sad. Well, I've been pushing Cleveland hard, and then that came out. I was like, well, maybe Cleveland's just going to Cleveland this year again.
And they just traded Corey Coleman, their like receiver from last year.
You know, be Jarvis Landry's pushing really hard to get OBJ there. You know, the LSU connection.
They don't have a lot of money. The Browns are kind of running out of money. That's what they...
How is that possible?
They spent a lot of money this year. Landry was like the highest paid receiver now.
That's crazy.
I mean, he went after some people this year.
I think I called them to win four games. I'm actually going to call them to win two.
I'm still saying they're gonna sniff 500.
Yeah, I think they go 500 as well. They've got too many weapons.
I think that's actually pretty good.
I still think they bomb.
That's what might keep them going.
Well, plus they're in a bad division. Pittsburgh's good, but they're, in my opinion, I think they're on the decline. And then Cincinnati, give me a break. Baltimore, they don't scare me at all either. So.
Yeah, but both of those are, in my opinion, way better than Cleveland.
I don't think Cincinnati is at all. I think Cincinnati. I don't know what Andy Dalton's going to do this year, but. I don't know. They are who they are.
Yeah, I can't see Marvin Lewis keeping that job after this year.
No, I could see them being a top five pick in the draft next year. Mm-hmm. They don't have. There's just nothing there. There's nothing there.
So talking about how everybody's going to do next year. I mean, what about that NFL report that you mentioned earlier, James?
Yeah, NFL Network came out with their power poll and have the Jags sitting pretty at number two. behind Philadelphia only, Super Bowl champs. Cool. I think Patriots were three, and I don't have the list on the top of my head. I think four was an NFC team.
Maybe, or the Rams maybe, or the Vikings.
Rams. It was the Rams. Yeah. It was the Rams. So I like it.
It was the Eagles at one, Jaguars two, Patriots three, Rams four, and that's the four that I see on Twitter.
Yeah. I think that alone is proof that Miles Jack wasn't down.
There you go.
NFL agrees.
Yeah. I mean, power polls are just for the offseason. They don't mean anything at all, but I like it. You know, the NFL Network likes the Jags. It's other national.
The Saints are sixth on the power poll.
Well, there, yeah.
So there we go. 2v6 matchup tomorrow night.
I guess on the WWE, the Raw series that came through here, there was like thousands of those, like, Miles Jack wasn't down signs. Like, everyone awesome. Brought him out for it.
It's fantastic. Gotta love Jacksonville.
There's one thing I associate with Jacksonville is wrestling fans. I feel like that's like...
Hey, listen, I, in my day...
I've been to many a sellouts at that stadium, man.
Listen, when I was in college... my freshman year of college, I may have camped out at Veterans Memorial Arena for the old one. Coliseum, for WCW Monday Nitro tickets. I got there at like midnight and made it on... We were on the seventh row. We got there at like midnight and there was 10 people in front of us. We're like, we're going to get ringside. This is going to be amazing. And we got to the window. And this is before like Ticketmaster flooded and all that stuff. You know, people just bought everything there. We ended up getting seventh row. Like, what? Are you kidding me? Wow. But it ended up being amazing because where we were at, where it was right on the aisle where the wrestlers came out. So every time they came out, the camera panned us, and we were on national television like 20 times. It was great. Best night of my life. Until the Jags win the Super Bowl in February. That's the best night of my life.
Nothing wrong with some wrestling, man.
No. It's good stuff. Good wholesome entertainment. Maybe.
Maybe not the 90s.
Yeah, I don't watch it anymore, but yeah, sure. I'm not gonna hate on anybody. Listen, I've tried, and I don't know. It's like I don't know who these people are anymore.
As soon as Goldberg and The Rock got out of it, it was impossible for me to pay attention to anymore.
Yeah. But I can talk. I can talk some old school wrestling, no problem. But we're not gonna go there.
That's the next podcast. Yeah, another wrestling podcast. Yeah,
I say we let South Point close it out for us.
I think that's a great idea. I hope they're playing now over the top of what I so yeah, we do want to thank South Point again. The song is The Great Escape, but that's just one of many great songs that they have. They are, again, local guys in Jacksonville. They're Jaguar fans. And this is about the Jaguars, but it's also about the city of Jacksonville. We want to promote that because all four of us, born and raised Jacksonville residents, and we think the city has a lot of things to offer.
You can find them on Twitter at South Point Band.
Thank you. Perfect. And you can also find us on Twitter at Another Jags Pod and on Facebook and Instagram at Another Jags Podcast. If you're having trouble finding us in the podcast world, go to our website. It's still being built, but we have our links there. The website is anotherjagspodcast.com. So if you get confused on where to find us, go there and we'll have all the links for you. We're also on YouTube. Okay, so if you can't find us on iTunes or SoundCloud or you just don't know what those things are, go to YouTube, type in Another Jags Podcast, and you'll see all of our episodes there. Get caught up on all of what we talked about all offseason. Get ready for the regular season. Listen, we are your number one offseason Jaguars podcast, and in about a month, we're going to be your number one regular season Jaguars podcast. We can't wait. Tomorrow night, first preseason game. We're looking forward to it. As always, go Jags.